Okay, do you want to rock and roll?
Ready? Go for it.
I'm Ryan, I'm a CFO, I'm an officer. I think I've met most of you here and there. So I'm just based in F116. So this is going to be on promoting student wellbeing today. So just a bit of advice on some of the things that I do to try and promote the wellbeing of our students. So just starting with some statistics, really. So mental health problems. So most recent statistics, 1 in 6 children aged 5 to 16 are likely to have a mental health problem. So this figure's gone up quite significantly by up to 50% in the last 3 years. So what we're seeing a lot more of at the moment is emotion-based school avoidance. So the figures for 22-23 autumn showed that persistent absence rate was now at 22.3%. This was compared to pre-pandemic levels of 10.9%. So it's kind of looking at some of the reasons behind that. Obviously, the pandemic probably played a bit of a role in terms of the impact it had on young people, and we may be seeing some of this now, but I'll come on to this in a little bit. So we deal with instances of self-harm, body dysmorphia, so that's a mental health condition where a person spends a lot of time worrying about their appearance. So this has become obviously more of an issue with social media and some of the negative depictions of body image we see there. Okay, so I think one of the first things we try to do is identify the protective factors. So by protective factors, we're looking at the sources of support already available to young people. So we try to identify, do the young people have support at home? Do they have supportive parents? Looking at the wider family, because sometimes our young people aren't on good terms with parents, so it's looking at whether we have family members who can support, friends, support groups, and also professionals. We try to identify unmet needs. So does this person have a support need that is at this point unmet? So it might be that there are financial issues within the family. And we try to support with that in college, try to put them in contact with groups that can support, and obviously make referrals to food banks and those kinds of things. But we also look at professional support. So does the person need support from a mental health professional? But also support from a social perspective, because a lot of the issues our students face, I think, have a social solution. So social prescribing involves prescribing students to social sources of support. So if we have, for example, a student who comes to us and maybe is feeling lonely, having difficulties making friends, it might be that the kind of support they need to be kind of referred to a group where they can meet other students and form friends, so maybe something like an extracurricular activity in college. Encouraging the students to open up. So often students are really reluctant to do this and they feel like they're going to be a burden on their close ones. But I often tell the students that actually, you know, if they're not feeling very good, that's probably coming off at home and the parents are probably really worried about them. So it's actually better to open up, and that would actually be less of a burden for their close ones, so they know what's going on within their lives. And try to remove some of the negative influences that are affecting the students. So talked about body dysmorphia, so maybe trying to get students to remove themselves from harmful content that they're accessing on social media. Self-care. So self-care might sound like quite a fuzzy term, so I'm just going to talk about what I mean by self-care. I think it's about ensuring that you find time within our busy lives to do the things that bring us happiness. And that's quite hard to do. We all have quite hectic schedules, but it's important to find that time. So this is a picture from High Cup Nick in Cumbria in the North Pennines. And I remember once when I was on a walk here with my mum and I saw this view, and it kind of struck within me a love for nature. And that's one of the things that I do for my self-care, is that I go out into green spaces. So every day I try to go for a walk, and you know, going off into the hills on a weekend, that's one of the things that brings me happiness and makes me feel better. And I try to encourage our students to do that. So a lot of our students, they might spend a lot of time at home, might spend a lot of time, you know, just in the rooms on games and things like this. And it's probably, you know, it's better for them if they do try to get outside, because, you know, nature has been shown to have a profound effect on mental health. So it boosts serotonin and our dopamine levels in the brain. The NHS Scotland's recently been prescribing that people with mental health problems spend more time in nature. So biophilia is a concept that, you think of it in evolutionary terms, we evolved in quite natural settings, so that's kind of our natural environment, whereas nowadays we live in quite built-up areas, built-up towns and cities, so a lot of our lives are deprived from this. So I do really try to encourage our students to get get out into nature more. But really, self-care, it's all about what makes you happy and what makes our students happy. So I speak to our students and I try to find out, what is it that makes you happy? If a student's coming to me and they tell me that they're stressed, I say, well, what are you doing in your own life to help with that? And a lot of the time, students aren't finding that time to do the things they enjoy, whether it's, you know, reading, whether it's gaming, whether it's getting exercise. So it's really important to get them to do those basic things and say, find a bit of time in the day to have a bit of you time and to do the things you enjoy. Building resilience. So we talked about the school avoidance issue. It's not possible or even in the long run desirable to avoid all of the things that make us uncomfortable. Okay, so if our students, obviously a lot of them feel anxious about coming into college, but in the long run, by avoiding college, it's not going to help them, is it? It's not going to set them up for employment in the future. So it is actually important to build resilience and to do the things that make us feel uncomfortable. So one of the techniques that I use with our students is something called graded exposure. So this involves actually incorporating those things we find uncomfortable in our lives to build up resilience against them. So I had a student who I worked with last year who had really bad social anxiety, and it was affecting a lot of aspects of his life. And I remember him telling me that he was having difficulties. He wasn't getting enough food during the day, so I was asking him about this, and the issue actually turned out to be that he was too nervous to go to the cafe in college because he'd never bought anything before. He never actually had that exchange where he sort of hand over money and receive some because he was too afraid of the social interaction. So for me, I thought, well, okay, let's start from scratch. Let's actually build up a plan where I say every week I send you a bit of homework. So this week, I said, first week I said, your homework is go and get something from the cafe, right? We'll start really small. Then I said, next week, go and speak to someone from your class who you've never spoken to before. And every week I just gradually built that up. And now the student's he's doing really well now. He's got a group of friends, he's got a girlfriend in college. But when I first met him, he wouldn't speak to anyone. So graded exposure, it's all about taking those small steps. We don't chuck the student in at the deep end, but we gradually build the confidence up. And that's the important thing. So, you know, we need to build resilience because if we always tell the young person, actually, you'll be able to avoid that uncomfortable situation. You won't have to do a presentation in your class. If we always get them to avoid that situation, they'll never build this resilience up, and it's not going to help them in the long run. So it's just trying to get those small steps in and build the confidence. Challenging negative thoughts. So one of the things I also do with students is I get them to write down the negative thoughts that they're having. And rather than just let the thoughts hang there, I actually encourage them to challenge the thoughts. So I get them to write in the evidence against the negative thoughts they're having. So I remember having students who said, I don't feel like I'm worthy of being in college. So I said, okay, well, let's write down the evidence against that. And it turned out the student actually had really good grades. You know, so he's actually doing really well, but just had that lower self-confidence. So it's just about drawing their attention to the positives and to the strengths that they've got. Because often, you know, sometimes students, maybe at home, they're not reminded about the strengths that they've got. So that's something we can do. And that strength-based approach is really important. Goal setting. So this is another important thing. So students will often question, you know, what's the point in doing this? Why do I need to do this exam? What's the point of it? And yeah, you could say something like, well, it's to get good grades or it's to go to university. But I try to say, well, look at the bigger picture. Where do you want to be in 5 years' time? What's your ultimate goal? And they maybe say, well, I want a career in architecture, or it could be anything. I want to be a teacher. And we say, well, that's the reason. That's the reason you're doing the exam. It's not just to get high grades. It's not just to go to university. It's because you're building your future. So, yeah, just about reminding them of the bigger picture. So this is something that we use in our division. It's called the continuum of need. It just enables us to triage support for our students to make sure they get the right level of support. So this is a Pan-Lancashire document. It's used by Lancashire County Council. So at level one here, we've got universal services, so these are available to all students in college. Level two, we've got universal plus. So this is when maybe a student has some lower level mental health concerns, but we have our pastoral mentors to support students here. Level three is the more intensive support, so this is maybe more concern and safeguarding issues. And what's happening more recently is that schools are doing more and more of this work, and this work used to be more social services, but more recently it's been incorporated in college. So that's just the kind of insight of the guide that we use when we triage our students for support. So just some information on the support we have in college for if you need to put a referral through for our students. So we have a team of pastoral mentors, and they provide one-to-one support with students around, I suppose, the lower-level mental health concerns. So just some of the kind of concerns that I've mentioned here. The student is lacking in confidence, self-esteem, anxiety, those kinds of problems. We have a qualified counsellor in college called Helen. So she does person-centred talk and therapy. And we also have our safeguarding staff. So what we deal with, I suppose, are the more high-level concerns, maybe about things like suicidal ideation, self-harm, and those kinds of things. We also work to support our young people in foster care, and we know that people in foster care are often very disadvantaged, and so it's important that they get that extra support to make sure that they're able to thrive, and that's where you guys come in. So we often do things called pet meetings, which are all about the educational progress of our looked after young people. So we will send out emails to you guys for advice on that, because obviously we don't know how they're doing in college. So your insight on those things are really important to help those students. And this is just some information on how to access our team. So we're based in F116. This is our email address. You can call us at this number. We do drop-ins in the PLZ on Mondays and Fridays, so students don't have to make appointments for those, so you can tell them if they want to speak to one of us, they can just come to those. But if you have any concerns outside of college hours, then please just obviously, if it's an emergency, you know, get in touch with emergency services. But there are plenty of other support services available, so just let me know if you want any of the contact details for those. And that's everything, so thank you very much.
There are pan au chocolat still left. In a slight difference to what I normally do, I'm going to tell you what we're doing next week. So you can give it a try, and then you can ask questions when you come in. So Kath Dallas is delivering next week on Wordwall. So some of you may have used Wordwall, some of you have never heard of it. But if you haven't tried it, maybe give it a go, and you're going to see an example of it next week. It's got loads of different stuff on it. So that's next week. All right? Thanks, folks.
Chris, all right.